Indie heartthrob Sam Fender quickly retracted an Instagram post he made a few days ago, branding Johnny Depp a serious hero in a selfie he took with the actor alongside guitarist Jeff Beck somewhere up in Newcastle. Sam Fender wrote one of my all-time favorite songs, It's a blame game, it's a fame trap, it's the martyrdom of the spoken, it's the last breath of the awoken. And the woke kids are just dickheads, and the dickheads are all ages. I don't have time for the very few. They never have time for me and you. I don't have time for the very few. They never have time for me and you. What I like about Sam Fender is that he is honest, especially about human beings being inherently flawed and fuck-ups. I completely agree, and I love his music for this reason alone. And so I will take this Instagram post as I take everything I see online. Fascinating social artifacts to explore and analyze. Of course, Sam Fender was saying that he admires Johnny and Beck insofar as they are musical idols, but the timing was pretty specific. And if you haven't listened to Sam Fender, please do. His music throbs. But this isn't about Sam Fender, but the context surrounding his Instagram post, namely the recent verdict of the Depp versus Heard defamation trial. Finally, it has come to an end. It has come to an end, and we can get back to our lives and hopefully restore relationships.
What is this music? It's so ominous. It's so like, it's like true crime. I don't love it. I hate it. You guys know I hate background music so much. I just feel like it's such a manipulation tactic. I want you to feel this way, so I'm going to tell you what music is supposed to make you feel which way. I hate it.
Owned by two multi-millionaires who decided to bring the intricacies of their tumultuous relationship to our screens and feeds.
Amber Heard is not a multi-millionaire anymore. She is -8 million.
Firstly, I'd like to say that I completely respect the verdict that was reached. And I must say, I was not expecting this outcome, considering that many a legal expert beyond the domain of social media thought a Johnny Depp victory tricky to achieve in the US legal system. And when I refer to legal experts, I'm specifically talking about those beyond YouTube, whom, like the rest of us, want clicks before everything else. I hadn't expected Johnny to win every single count, which he didn't. Amber Heard was awarded $2 million. Johnny Depp was awarded $15 million, of which he will likely only see $8.35 million due to Virginian laws placing a cap on punitive damages claims. Heard was awarded after the jury determined that she had also been defamed when Johnny's lawyer had told the Daily Mail in 2020 that Amber's abuse allegations were, and I quote, a hoax. Going on the history of defamation cases in the US and the UK, it is a lot easier to win a defamation case in the UK, considering that the right and the freedom of speech is not protected under constitutional dictates. We in the UK do not have a codified constitution. And so, I'll admit, it was quite unprecedented to see this outcome, considering that Amber Heard had not even named Johnny Depp as her abuser in the piece, which
she didn't name him, but in the court, she would be like, I was writing that in general. And then at one point when she got mad at Johnny, she was like, am I being punished for writing this article on Johnny? I was like, so you did write it on Johnny. Like, it's so annoying.
Started this entire defamation trial. I'd also like to say that I am a big Johnny Depp fan, particularly of his independent films. And on a selfish level, I am thrilled that he likely will have to resort more and more to independent film projects as opposed to blockbuster Hollywood films due to the undeniable sullying of his reputation. I think in the short term, Hollywood is going to be all over him. But Hollywood is also very liberal and still very much committed to its hashtag MeToo campaign. So I doubt that once Johnny becomes old news.
I liked the second Alice in Wonderland way better than the first one. I liked the second one a lot.
As is the nature of these sorts of things, Hollywood will alter its ways. Independent films add more value to the arts than franchises and blockbusters, in my humble opinion. 90s Johnny Depp would be a hell of a treat for us artsy independent filmgoers. Give me a What's Eating Gilbert Grape any day. based on the internet and social media, America is pretty much on the side of Johnny Depp in perceiving him as a victim of domestic abuse. Similarly, numerous polls have drawn the same conclusion, that Americans have been far more interested in following and understanding and being vocal participants in this case, relative to showing the same amount of interest in other global events and also in rather harrowing and heartbreaking national events. As such...
Okay, so I have this theory that, like, with freedom comes less desire for responsibility. I think in America, we do this thing where we don't force our kids to really go to school. We don't really force a lot on our children. Like, generally speaking, America doesn't rank top in anything. And a big part of it is because we have freedom. And when people have a lot of freedom, we don't choose to be disciplined. We choose to, like, break rules and be gluttonous and follow drama. But also, then we start focusing on our personal relationships and, like, our favorite bands and what we want to do. And so it is sort of interesting that in some ways it's really good that people wanted to focus on celebrities because they're probably not the people who are going to go start a war. Like, funny enough, if you're actually super involved in politics, you might be the ones, like, if you're in politics, you might be the one advocating for, like, violence or protesting, and you might be a part of the problem versus somebody who just stays home and talks about Kim Kardashian's butt or whatever is in the news today. They're not going to advocate for violence in the same way. Now, someone in politics could advocate for violence in a way by using drama to advocate for violence. But it is kind of funny, you know what I mean? Like, thinking about just even my own choices. Like, the only reason I would ever choose to be more responsible is because I need to be more responsible. But it's hard work. It's like, don't you also just want to do nothing all day? Unless you're the type, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know, there's something here that's, like, good and bad. But she's just demonizing it in general. Like, people should pay more attention to what's happening in the world, but then is making videos about Amber Heard and Johnny Depp. So I get it, girl, but admit it, you like talking about it. Admit it, it's fun talking about Johnny Depp and Amber Heard. You chose to do it. This is our second video of Kidologies we're watching, and they're both on that subject. So it's like... You know what I mean? It's like the levels. Everyone always says I'm retarded for doing the levels, but then goes around saying you're such a two, I'm such a one. Admit it. You like it. You can say you hate all these things, but, like, look how much we love utilizing it in our language. Don't kids have compulsory education in most of the U.S.? Does that mean, like, they have to do school? You can drop out at 16. Is that what you mean? E.A. Johnson, stop saying R slur. Slurs are made up concepts. You know we had to make them up to be slurs. You know it's just voice noises. In some bubbles, you can still say retarded. Unless YouTube tells me I can't say it, I'm gonna keep saying it. Basically, YouTube is the boss of me. If YouTube says I can't say it, I won't say it. But literally, we just made up that word. It doesn't mean anything unless we want it to mean something. And in this case, it means stupid.
The world has to follow suit. But when comparing the media coverage of this case, it is interesting to draw comparisons between US media and US social media relative to media and social media in the United Kingdom. And with that aside, let's consider the UK legal system.
E.A. Johnson says, I guess I could say the N-word without consequences. Probably. You probably could say it in many situations without consequences. Don't be a pussy. Do you know what I'm saying? Say it if you want to say it. Obviously, there are consequences if somebody hears you and they don't like it, if they want to do something about it. Like, you know what I'm saying? Don't say it. Don't say it, Chatters. I don't fucking...
and its depiction, and namely its verdict on Johnny Depp. Within the UK legal system, Johnny Depp is considered no hero, nor a victim. He has been nationally branded a...
Don't be a pussy, say slurs. I'm just kidding. Stop the freedom. Y'all, that's what I'm saying. Nobody really wants freedom. Everybody wants to censor people. Admit it, you fucking hate freedom. You hate it.
a, quote, wife beater since ex-wife Amber Heard published her notorious op-ed in the Washington Post detailing her history of domestic abuse. Importantly, she never named Johnny Depp by name. Following this, news outlets in the UK began openly speculating, putting two and two together before labeling Johnny Depp a, quote, unquote, wife beater. Johnny subsequently took Newsgroup Newspapers Limited and then executive editor of The Sun, Dan Wootton, to court for libel in July 2020. In their defense, NGN, alongside Don Wootton, who had in fact authored The Sun article titled Gone Potty, How Can J.K. Rowling Be Genuinely Happy Casting Wife Beater Johnny Depp?
Whoa, that's a dramatic fucking title, bro. It's a dramatic fucking title. How can J.K. Rowling be genuinely happy? And then everyone's like, well, of course J.K. Rowling supports Johnny Depp. She's a transphobe. Y'all are pussies, bro. Pussies.
In the new Fantastic Beast film, cited 14 instances of domestic violence committed by Johnny against Heard. Amber was called to give evidence on behalf of NGN and Wootton. And this is ultimately where things get a little complicated. The UK High Court of Justice determined that Wootton's piece in The Sun had not in fact been libelous. The great majority of alleged assaults of Ms. Heard by Mr. Depp have been proved to the civil standard. Amber's evidence was concluded to have been substantively true. And
Angelica says J.K. Rowling being Twitter's favorite villain is retarded. J.K. Rowling being Twitter's favorite villain. You know what's so funny though? She's such a pussy too. J.K. Rowling, I don't think it will ever stop being amusing to me watching like really grown adults be totally childish. Just like Jordan Peterson. She's not beautiful. Period. It's like, okay, Jordan. I'm not sorry. So dumb. Sit down, you old man. Why do people just like, nobody fucking cares.
12 of the 14 instances determined to also be true, officially proved to a civil standard. Johnny Depp was also unsuccessful in getting the verdict appealed. And now let's fast forward to the present. In the US, the public opinion most definitely played a role in the final verdict. And by public opinion, I don't mean social media. I mean the public opinion insofar as a jury's verdict and final decision was concerned. I mean the jury insofar as it is composed of members of the public. In the UK, however, UK High Court Justice Andrew Nicol determined quite a different verdict, and this verdict still stands.
Oh my god. Oh my god. Bryson, I won't masturbate to her. You can't make me, Jordan Peterson. Literally, it's like, oh my god, stop. Oh, it's so funny. Oh, it's so funny. Fuck.
And notably, this verdict was reached without a jury decision or presence. I noted in my previous video on this that it was no neutral decision of Johnny Depp and his legal team to have this defamation trial take place in the state of Virginia. And this was a fantastic strategic move insofar as ensuring that public opinion would most definitely play a role in Johnny's favor. Yes, and I'd say that this could particularly be seen by the mixed response to Johnny's defamation trial and unsuccessful appeal back in 2020. Not only had that trial tarnished the image of Johnny Depp, but also of Amber Heard. In the state of Virginia, a court may, solely in its discretion, permit cameras in judicial proceedings, insofar as upholding the rights of the jury.
Wait. Beautiful, subjective Jordan, we are not just monkeys. And then Jordan Peterson does this thing where he goes, women are supposed to be biologically attractive to us, young, in shape, blah, blah, blah. He goes, it's the mating selection and how it goes. And I'm like, I guess. But then he's like, we are more than just animals. We are like convictions and our morals. And I'm like, make a decision. I feel like we're both. And there are parts of us that are always going to have our animal brain. Like, oh, that's an animal brain thought. And like, I want to fuck that guy. Regardless of the consequences, that's a monkey thought. And then there's, hey, I really want to fuck that guy, but I need to consider the consequences. And that's like logical brain. Okay. You have to have a balance with both of those. So like you could say, ooh, biologically, you know, I'm not really attracted to that person's body, But you know what? Like, logically and romantically, I'm actually quite suitable with this person, and I find that that outweighs this, and I'm actually able to, like, form a relationship with this person. Like, ideally, we always have our ideal partners, the partner in our head that we imagine are, like, who we're going to marry and who we're going to be with, and then we have the actual person we end up with, and there's always going to be, like, compromise, or there's always going to be sort of, like, you know, like my friend brother said he wanted, like, a wife with blonde hair and got a dark-haired woman. My sister-in-law wanted a guy with hair. She married a bald Middle Eastern man. It's like they're never going to look like the perfect version, but hopefully their whole, who they are as a whole visual or whole entity is really what we're dating. The whole package, not just like one or two things. Because it's like, if that was the case, I would just marry someone who loved anime. But like, obviously that can't just be the only requirement, even though it is a major one.
General public to have direct access to its legal system. Mark Stevens, an international media lawyer, said the fact that the US case was heard before a jury while the UK trial was heard before a judge was significant. Because the US trial was before a jury, it allowed Depp's lawyers to focus on Heard, a well-worn tactic of defendants in domestic abuse cases, but one that was dismissed by the judge in the UK, Stevens said. They deny that their client, did anything. They deny they're the real perpetrator, and they attack the credibility of the individual calling out the abuse, and then reverse the roles of the victim and the offender. What is worth noting is that jurors in this defamation case were not sequestered. That is, they were not isolated or...
This background music is driving me fucking crazy. It's driving me crazy! Garrett says, can you be a pal and try to shit on DGG more? We need to make a cult against DGG. No! No, no, no. No, I do not want my kids fighting Destiny's kids. I like Destiny. Steven's a friend of mine now. I will protect Steven by letting our kids get along. DGG, you are now my children. I would never shit on DGG. They are my sons.
Or kept hidden from the public at large. They were instructed not to read about the trial online, yet their phones were not taken away from them. In the UK, Amber was determined to be a credible witness. In the US, she clearly was not, and evidence brought forward by Depp's expert LaBelle legal team placed considerable emphasis on Amber being a less than credible witness. And it is important to note these different strategies taken by Depp's legal team in July of 2020 relative to their far more pressing and highly effective strategy taken in the last 6 weeks. And what were some of these new strategies? Well, there were many. He got himself a new legal team.
Stop, Discord! Discord calls us the levelers because they know that's my nightmare. My nightmare is someone is seriously going to call themselves a leveler and be like, I'm a level 3 in their Twitter profile. I'm going to fucking kill myself. But Discord says, I can't believe YouTube chat would think the levelers would hate DGG. We love DGG. We love you.
They definitely came far more prepared and ready for action. It is definitely notable to me that Amber and her legal team were not prepared for the influence of public opinion to be so all-encompassing and so strong. But one strategy which researchers and experts alike have been fascinated by, not necessarily insofar as reaching a consensual conclusion on how it was used and deployed by which party in this trial.
Yes! Angelica says DGG's is the annoying little brothers. 100%. That's why we love them. Because they're like, oh, they're like little boys. It's like sweet boys. Sweet boys. And they're just like, I love them. I love them. I love them all. Stop, Garrett. I hate DGG. You are DGG. Don't even try to play. DGG is both a good community and extremely bad one. Blink if Del Qaeda is in the room with you right now. Save me.
Was the Davo tactics. And this has been an interesting one for researchers and academics beyond the social media sphere. What is noteworthy is that the more high profile and social media presence legal professionals have, the substantially more likely they were to be.
Wait, Alice, what are you saying? Will I get kicked out of the cult if I ask what DGG is? It's Destiny's children. It's Destiny's audience. We are watching.
be on Johnny Depp's side of the fence. Take from that what you will. I just thought I would put it out there. DAVO stands for Deny, Attack, and Reverse Victim and Offender. In trying to deny accountability for their actions, a perpetrator of violence or abuse will resort to such tactics. And this is particularly seen in cases of sexual or domestic violence when brought to trial. In the case of Depp and Heard, the fact that both made damning accusations of violence and assault against one another has made it nigh impossible for analysts, psychologists, and social scientists, let alone us laypersons, to make a sound judgment on how such tactics may or may not have been deployed during the trial. And this is very important to consider, because we live in an online age in which the victim mentality reigns. And this is perfectly understandable. We are living through very precarious times in which being heard or acquiring the thing which we as humans desire more than anything, that is attention, is becoming more and more difficult to acquire. And in this world, we try to make things as understandable as possible. And by doing that, it means that we have
I'm not getting the point of this video yet, but I could also be zoning out. So we're still going to keep watching it. People keep saying this is the girl who talked to Mr. Girl. Yes, yes. So Kidology did have a collaboration with Mr. Girl. I couldn't watch it all. I got kind of just like, I was zoning out. And I also unsubscribed from Mr. Girl, and I'm also not following his content anymore. So unless, excuse me, I see Mr. Girl on someone else's channel, I'm no longer consuming Mr. Girl content. So
have to, unfortunately, ignore.
But I do want to watch him talk to Erudite tonight, because I'm a Kyla fan. She is the ultimate top.
The complex nature of reality, and how in reality, oftentimes there is not, in fact, that clear victim-abuser dichotomy. The fostering of a clear victim-abuser dichotomy was excellently done by Johnny Depp's legal team. The National Coalition Against Domestic Violence, a resource which provides information for determining the central aggressor of violence in a relationship, has determined that it is, and I quote, difficult to determine who is the core aggressor, especially when both people in a relationship use violence. That is, contrary to the widespread image and belief that domestic abuse is a binary, it isn't necessarily as clear as all that. The National Coalition Against Domestic Violence tries, for legal purposes, as best it can, to establish who in a relationship is the core aggressor and who is the primary victim. What is important in this distinction is core and primary, because these two qualifiers importantly diminish the dichotomy. They diminish the binary, demonstrating realistically, and as is correct, that life is far more complicated than we give it credit for. As far as both defamation trials went, both Depp and Heard were determined by the respective courts to have been abusive during their marriage, physically, emotionally, and verbally. Neither has truly taken accountability for their actions, because in order to win a case, it is important to make things seem as concise and straightforward as possible. The grays and blurs of real life will get nowhere, and clearly, for both parties, time was money. The victim mentality of both was such that neither proved willing to take responsibility for the state of their marriage, nor a willingness to see both as mutually fostering what was clearly an undesirable situation, and their diminishing careers as a consequence. But I'd like to, of all things, make a reference to a Twitter thread which I happened upon. It was written by sociologist Nicole Badira of the University of Michigan. If you're following the Depp trial, you have probably seen a lot of women saying some version of, I'm a survivor, and as a real survivor, I can tell you that you shouldn't believe Amber Heard. Why is this happening? First, it's worth noting that survivors are a heterogeneous group. Perpetrators do not pick victims based on their political beliefs, and experiencing violence is not always a radicalizing event for women. I conducted my dissertation work in a conservative state, and there were a lot of conservative victims who insisted that I should believe them, but not other women. One even emailed me a Jordan Peterson video to try to convince me to write a victim blaming.
This is actually, this is like totally something that I think about all the time. And I'm sorry, I know, like, she's hard to listen to because, you know, she makes me tired, but I think it's her music, too. The music makes me zone out. Like, I actually hate, I think, I can't tell if they put music in their videos to not only manipulate how you feel and to create a vibe, which is fine. Not manipulation is not always bad. But, like, also if it makes people zone out so they forget to click off the video. Because, like, the music makes me tired. So, okay. You think she's too monotone? Well, I mean, she's got one of those monotone accents, so that makes sense. But you know what's interesting is, like, I do see this happening. I actually don't like it either. I didn't like that people were like, real victims don't act like Amber Heard. I don't like that. But I will say Amber Heard acts in with dishonest energy. So I think that's the issue, is that Amber does act with dishonest energy. She's got an energy to her, the way her face moves, the way she wants people to empathize with her, feels performative. So when I think people are saying she's not acting like a real victim, what we're also saying is she doesn't feel like a real victim, which I think is accurate. You know what I mean? Do you eat your boogers? Gross. No. Gross. Ugh. Ugh. Gross. But that's what I mean. It's like, ugh. Boys are gross. I have so many stories about boys eating their boogers. But anyways, oh my God, boys are gross. Well, babies are gross. Anyways, listen, I've been really thinking about this, how there's not really like a black and white, all victims act this way. I hate that idea. But I feel like the way their energy is can tell me if they've really been through something. You know, when you meet someone, you're like, oh, you've been through something for sure. And then you meet other people and you're like, I can't tell, but it feels like you haven't been through something. Now, that feeling is going to be what we can recognize in people. So you might not have the skill to also recognize when people have been through something if it isn't similar to what you've been through. So do not mistake your inability to tell with a person's lack of a story. But also, Amber just has this energy that for me, I'm like, I don't believe you. Like, I just don't believe you. I didn't believe you when it first started. I don't believe you now. Now, I will say Johnny gives me the energy of somebody who's overall a really good person, but has definitely had toxicity within his life. Hold on. Loud noises. Which would make sense because he's not only was a child in Hollywood, but did have an abusive background with his parent, with his mother. And so, like, I feel like a lot of this is I can be forgiving to people who grew up in toxic lifestyles and mimic that toxicity, but I can't be sympathetic or empathetic to people who are in denial that they are repeating patterns. Amber never admits she's a bad person, not even once. Johnny admits consistently that he has failings, and that makes me trust him more. It's like they say people who cuss are more trustworthy because they're honest. But the thing is that it's not the cussing that makes them more honest. It's just the idea that they'd be willing to break social faux pas that make you feel more comfortable with them. Because it's like, well, they're going to do what they're going to do. I'm watching this stupid fucking show, the business proposal show. And literally, he likes her because she breaks the social norms. And he says, I like her because she's honest. It's like there is a form of breaking social norms that is honesty and a form of it that's just bad manners. And finding out the difference is so key. It's like the difference between an activist who's like, I'm going to dress this way because I'm making a stance. And a person who's just like, hey, I just want to dress this way because this is who I am. One feels more authentic to us. Well, one feels performative, right? So, yeah. Let's see. What are you guys saying? She never felt like she was telling her story. She always felt like she was trying to convince me, which was very unconvincing. Just tell the story, girl. Exactly, Bryson. That's how I felt, too. I felt like she was trying to convince me the whole time. Candy says, I would definitely agree, Brittany. I didn't believe her as a victim. I can't really say exactly why. I know people act different, but she wasn't genuine. Yeah. There was something about her energy where I'm not saying victims can't act like Amber Heard, but it feels like Amber Heard is pretending to act like what she thinks a victim acts like. Which is why it feels fake. Versus when a person's just a victim, I'm like, oh, I can tell you've been through some shit. You know, I feel like I'm really lenient towards people who have gone through some shit and really resentful of people who pretend they've gone through some shit. If that makes sense. And that's not to say, like, if this isn't a class thing. I think rich people can really go through some shit and poor people could go through no shit. It just depends on what you call, quote unquote, going through the shit too. My dog stepped on a bee. No. Nimbus, the husky, he got bit by a bee once on the nose. It was so sad. I cried. I cried. Okay, let's see. Hold on. I did a mock trial in high school from Docking Mule and was told as a witness to always address the jury since the person asking the question, and if 99% of the time knows the answers already, you should answer to the jury. Very interesting. It's Amber's lies, lack of clarity, and performative behavior. That too. Johnny, Angelica says, feels like he probably is toxic, but he's aware and ultimately good. Exactly. For sure. I can definitely cope around people that are aware of it. I think Mr. Girl attempts to do this where he's like, see, I admit I'm toxic. But he doesn't actually ever admit he's toxic. Not if it makes him actually look bad. He doesn't actually want to be held accountable for the things he's done. He doesn't actually want to be treated like a person who's hit his girlfriend, but he wants to be a person who can say he hit his girlfriend and he might snap again. You know what I mean? It's like that's the consequence of saying these things is that people might be uncomfortable with you. And it's you understanding that that makes you remorseful. If you can understand, like, you did something and it makes sense that people wouldn't want to be around you, you are more trustworthy because, again, you're being more honest. You're saying, yeah, of course people would be worried about being around me. But the fact that you say, like, people shouldn't be worried to be around me is insane because then you're not understanding other people and why they would be fearful. Does that make sense? So that's what Destiny was trying to explain to Mr. Girl. Like, you're acting like the logical thing to do is to reason through you hitting your girlfriend. But the logical thing to do is also to be aware of other people's feelings in regards to your actions. So it's like you have to fulfill the cycle. You can't just do one part of the work and not the second part of the work.
In dissertation, these women are particularly likely to express anger at other women who speak out because they are ruining my credibility. Survivors who hold these ideologies are particularly likely to be elevated by groups like men's rights activists. They see sexist women as legitimizing their movement as not about gender and not about hate. There's a reason so many of the men's rights activist groups who focus on college sexual violence, for example, are, at least symbolically, headed by women. And there are women happy to take on that role, especially if it confers them some privileges and protections in the usually white heteropatriarchy. There are a lot of gendered tropes of acceptable, again white, femininity that center on empathizing with men, like the cool girl trope, or the idea that a good mother will defend her son from the consequences of a rape allegation, even if she believes he is guilty. That type of femininity is very much on display right now. And the women who engage in it do get tangible results, even if they don't get equality, such as being the one victim a misogynist believes was rarely raped. There's another problem at play too. Survivors are experts in their experience, but not necessarily all experiences of gender-based violence. Mm-hmm. And some will begin to rank other survivors' stories based mm-hmm. on how similar they are to their own. The tactics per...
We did this in Discord. We did this in Discord like months ago. We were ranking our trauma and deciding who had the worst trauma. And it is really funny to do because ultimately, like, you probably shouldn't do it. But I also feel like it's fun to have a safe space where you can do it because it allows you to step outside of your head and not be just like such a main character and go, yeah, maybe I haven't had it as worse as other people. And at the same time, you don't want to just be like, I don't have it as worse as other people, so I don't deserve to be in pain. Because I deal with that where I'm like, my job's not hard, so I don't have the right to complain about being sick about my job. But then as like my nutritionist and my friends pointed out, like, well, ultimately, it's hard for you. So my job might be really easy for other people, but for me, it's hard, but it's easy. Like, there's not physical labor, but there's a lot of emotional labor. Or even the fact that I'm like, you know, as I move through my sickness, I just have to like move through the pain. Like the other day when Melina and Erudite and I were going to stream, I told the girls like, hey, I'm running behind. I need some time. And Melina's running behind. So it was perfect. And I was like, yeah, my body's really hurting today. And she was like, oh, do we need to stream a different day? And I was like, oh, no, because this is the new normal. And I'm going to have to stream through the pain now, like normally, or at least for now, whatever that pain threshold is. And it is interesting, like having that understanding that for other people, right, it might be easy, but for you, it might not be as easy. And I think that's ultimately what we all have to know is that for some people, getting raped or seeing like a massacre in front of them might just be a part of what they call like an everyday life. And it sucks, but that's life. And then someone getting even, like, catcalled once could, like, traumatize them. I just feel like instead of ranking who has worse, you can do that. I think that's fine. You should also remember, like, everyone's ranking has to be in comparison to yourself and then to themselves. So if you're going to rank you against them, you have to also rank you against yourself. Like, is this trauma as bad for me because I'm me? You know what I mean? It's like there's a way to do it that's healthy and a way to do it that's toxic.
Perpetrators used to perpetrate are varied and often reflect the privileges they and their victims hold. But survivors who hold dominant identities, for example, whiteness, heterosexuality, can be quick to try to see their own privileged experiences as universal. It's one of the reasons the benefits of the hashtag me.
Whoa, I think that happens even on the other side, though. Even people who, like, hold a, like, I don't understand. I feel like, she's saying only dominant, like, kind of people feel this way. Because, you know, like, minority people also feel that way. Everyone who suffers thinks their suffering is always more important. Ask any, like, racially different group in America. If you ask them, they all think they're, like, the most picked on. Or the suffering. Or in the U.S., actually, you're not allowed to suffer more than black people. Yeah, said it out loud, bitch. Like, in America, in certain bubbles, you're not allowed to suffer more racially than black people in America. Which is very funny to me. Because, again, black people run into the same problem where they're, like, the monolith of suffering. And then all of a sudden, they're the dominant minority of suffering. And then all of a sudden, they're using the same tactics, like, majority people use, like, white people. Like, oh, I'm a victim because I'm the majority of this group. It's, y'all exhausted me. I am exhausted by existence. I'm exhausted. But, like, it's literally that. It's a, we're in a bubble and we're basically playing, like, a game of who's allowed to say they suffer the most. And I'm just, it's just so fucking boring.
Me Too movement haven't necessarily extended to women of color or poverty or working class women. The media version of the movement rarely centered white wealthy women's experiences. Of course, not all women speaking out against Amber Heard fit into either of these categories. There's another big reason that women try to distance themselves from high profile survivors, and it's based on something scholars call the just world theory. The simple version of the just world theory is that good things happen to good people and bad things happen to bad people.
Whoa. Are she saying Amber Heard is a high profile victim? Because I don't see her as a victim. I see her as, like, the predator in the situation.
That the world is fundamentally just, and women watching high-profile trials are invested in believing that to be true. It can be scary, and for victims, re-traumatizing. For women to...
Becca says it's very funny how white people aren't allowed to suffer these days. Oh, they can suffer. They just can't suffer for their whiteness because it doesn't make any sense. You know what I mean? Like, suffering because you're white makes no sense in America. You wouldn't... The only reason you would suffer if you're white is if you're around people of color that don't like you because you're white, which happens. But you're not going to be suffering because you're white in an all-white community. That doesn't make sense. But you could be suffering because you're in a white community that's going to torture you for the way you look, which is about culture within and not about your whiteness, unless you're a brown white person, whatever that means. I don't know. It's interesting.
To empathize with an abuse survivor. If violence really is everywhere, and if it feels like it can happen to anyone, then a lot of women will start to worry that they will be next. And that is too much for a lot of women to handle, especially over the course of a long trial. To avoid the psychological toll, women will refocus their empathy on a perpetrator because it is easier to stomach. Women invested in just world theory are also particularly likely to victim blame. By pointing out what a victim could or should have done differently, they can convince themselves that they would never experience that kind of violence. It's one of the reasons that women juries are particularly likely to acquit in gender-based violence cases. It's counterintuitive, but it can feel like an act of self-preservation in the moment. So is it surprising that a lot of women are coming to Depp's defense? No, not at all. It is completely consistent with the academic literature on how many women respond to disclosures of sexual violence, especially when they have some relationship to a perpetrator.
The dilemma is, I think this does happen. I've seen a lot of women, like, allow the men in their lives to get away with stuff. Like, I've even been there to some extent. And then I think about why we do that. And I think it's because if you love someone, you're, like, willing to forgo all their bad habits, for sure, or bad decisions, or sometimes even evil decisions. And I don't think that's necessarily wrong. I think what's wrong is lying to that person about their attitude as if it's good. I think that's a part of the problem. And so I don't, in the Amber Heard Johnny Depp case, though, guys, it's really hard to use them as an example of where the woman is being, like, given the short end of the stick. Because once again, like, for those of us who watched the trial, and I didn't even watch all of it, I just watched, like, half of it, maybe. When I was watching it, I was shocked that Amber didn't have an actual story. Like, I was shocked that she'd be willing to make these claims with no real story attached to them. It's so clear to me that Amber's obviously, like, lying about most of what she's experienced. And so that makes her automatically not a victim. And so I don't see how any of these things are happening in the Amber and Johnny Depp case. I see how they're happening in other cases. I see women, myself included, who've told women, like, but then you can make a decision, like, am I supposed to go save Shaylin and Mr. Girl? No, fuck off. Go be abusive and toxic to yourselves. I don't give a fuck. But that's what I'm trying to say is, like, Why do we feel like we should be intervening if grown adults want to be in toxic relationships? And also, like, can we not criticize those women and feel less sympathetic for people who stay in bad situations? And then people will say, well, Brittany, no one really ever stays in a bad situation of their own choice. Yes, they do. Yes, they do. Yes, they do. Like, I just don't understand why we're not allowing people. Like, if the rapist who's drunk is making a decision to rape someone while drunk, but the person who's drunk and didn't consent to being raped because they were drunk. Do you guys get what I'm saying? Either give people agency or don't. Or just take it case by case and don't generalize. I'd rather have that one where we're not going to generalize. Where we're going to say, let's, you know, I just don't understand why they're using this kind of, like, again, Amber Heard and Johnny Depp are not, this isn't, I don't think Amber Heard's the victim in this. I just don't see it. I don't see how she's the victim at all.
And this post intrigued me. I do, like everyone, have my own internal biases, but mainly because it really shed light on how the court of public opinion, specifically on social media, is very ill-equipped to pass judgment, dogmatic judgment, on an issue as complex as this.
I agree, generally speaking, but again, this case was broadcast and we were able to see all the evidence. So I think that's usually true, but I think this is the greatest example of a chance we actually have to have a good informed opinion because we can watch the case in real time. So if you didn't watch the case and you're giving an opinion about Johnny, and didn't Kidology say she didn't watch the court case, that she actually had been trying to avoid it? So again, I feel like Johnny Depp and Amber Heard's case is our one opportunity as a community to actually watch evidence come out in real time. You know what I mean? Versus a story where we're not getting the full, like, we weren't there. We weren't getting, like, the full, you know, that then I feel like people are really bad at making judgments. But with the Amber Heard and Johnny Depp case, you don't have to worry about that because the court case did it for you. Like, you can watch the whole court case. Do you know what I mean?
What this trial has really brought home for me is how we really oftentimes take for granted the assumption that American culture is global culture. I find this quite fascinating, considering that millennials and Gen Z are incredibly vocal about neocolonialism and neo-imperialism, but are quite oblivious to the fact that it is almost assumed that the rest of the world sees the world from an American social media lens. And you know what? This is actually quite understandable and is not necessarily me wagging my finger at anyone. The history of the internet and social media is very much based in the American context. Based on the internet alone, it is very easy to assume that Johnny Depp had evidence up his sleeve like nobody preceding him, that he was and is a fully fledged victim of domestic violence whose voice is finally being heard, no pun intended. I consider this to be a general issue with the internet, considering that it is so Americanized in and of itself. And I notice this conflation of US global culture in many a sphere, for instance, in the domain of race relations. I think a great deal has been missed regarding both of these trials. That is the defamation trial of July 2020 to November.
Sorry, I think it was Abba and Preach They said in the Johnny Depp Amber Heard case, nobody said, is this like a bad look for white women and white men? But when Chris Rock and Will Smith got into their fighting match at the awards, the question was, does this set black men back? And I think that's like also a reflection of where like each group is, culturally speaking. If you haven't had enough like representation of a certain group for long enough to create a different narrative in people's heads, they're not going to get it. They're not going to get that luxury. Like, we've been able to build a reputation in the heads of American people that white men are, like, committed, Christian, consistent, religious, solid fathers who come home to their wives every day, like, leave it to Beaver. But black communities haven't had enough of those stories told, so they're still under scrutiny. I mean, right now, if you go into, like, black YouTube or black Twitter, half that shit is conversations about how black men cheat and ditch their women. And on the other side, it's men who are black talking about being high-value men and being and talking about how, like, women are gold diggers while they're only dating gold diggers. So, like, right now, I think all of our communities, like, we grow in different ways. Like, people always ask me why there are more white people in BDSM. And I'm like, because white people have time on their hands. They're not being arrested at higher, like, you know, rates by the cops. They're not being... They're given jobs at better rates. Like, they're not being discriminated because of their hair or their name. So, like, they just have a lot more time and money to go spend their time at BDSM dungeons. Minority groups are still working hard to build the wealth to have enough leisurely time to go to a dungeon. Do you know what I'm saying? So it's like, when you think about why our communities are having, like, questions, or it's because of these things where... I don't know. It's like the way I felt growing up when 9/11 happened. We were like, we have to be the good representation of Middle Eastern people. You know what I mean? It's like you felt that. After 9/11, you felt obligated as Middle Eastern people to be the good Middle Eastern people. Because it felt like our whole reputation was going down the tank. And so you felt that pressure. And I don't know that white people have ever felt the pressure of, I have to be a good white person, until liberal white people. I think liberal Democrats feel that. Where liberal white people are like, I have to be the good white person, the white savior. I have to help black people. I have to help brown people. I'm the white savior. But I think they feel that. And look how shitty it is. Look how damaging it is. Like, don't you think it's just as shitty for black people to feel like I have to be the good black person as it is for the white people to be like, I have to be the white savior? Aren't you all tired? Are we not exhausted over this whole, like, I'm so tired. Aren't you guys tired?
And this one just passed. Neither one of these trials was a domestic violence case. Both trials were explicitly defamation trials, and as such, they were intent on establishing whether statements made by a particular party were false and or subsequently led to undermining and damaging their good reputation. Defamation is generally considered a tortious act, that is, a civil wrong that causes some sort of harm or damage to a claimant. Both of these trials were first and foremost about Johnny Depp regaining his reputation as an A-list celebrity and Hollywood actor. What I've also learned is that if you throw enough money at the law will reward you. It may take 2 years, but eventually it will. In fact, it is virtually impossible for anybody to know the truth of what actually happened in that absolute shamble of a marriage. Voice recordings are just that. Voices taken entirely out of context, void of the time and space, the emotion, and the important external factors which bring everything together. This trial was about reputation and the well-known fact that money can do wonders for one's reputation. And what it has also shown me is that, in fact, once we get over this current wave of interest and intrigue and moral and societal soul-searching in the way that we seem to think we are apparently doing, things won't change. Irrespective of whose side I am on, I am, in all honesty, not on anyone's side in this. I think that these are both just two celebrities who care about their image and their brand more than any.
Yes, celebrities are not human, they do not have feelings, and they do not matter. Like, celebrities are just people with money, bro. Or they're just people that people know. It's like Paris Hilton, where everyone was like, fuck Paris Hilton, she's just like a snobby bitch. And then you watch her documentary and you're like, holy shit. Like, she was literally in, like, an abusive camp for teenagers and, like, went through this whole thing. You know what I mean? Brittany, do you don't think both could be the abusers and also both victims? Ah! Here's what I mean to say by this. I think there's a difference between being... Like, look, when you're... Let's say you're breaking up with someone and you can go, hey, bitch, we were in a toxic relationship together. Let's just be honest and say we were both toxic and that was that. But if somebody starts playing a game... Like, if you start playing a game and you start saying, well, like, who suffered more? Well, someone's gonna win. And in this case, I think Johnny Depp suffered more than Amber Heard, but I think they were both toxic. But I think to which degree Amber was far worse because Amber lied and manipulated and told stories that weren't true and continued to tell stories that weren't true even after they were proven not true, right? But then there's, like, other people who... Like, they can be bad in their relationships. They can be the toxic ones. But they are not, like, they learned and won't make the mistake again. Or they weren't as bad. Like, if you're in a relationship with someone, and let's say you're really toxic, and then they cheat, and then they give you, like, an STI, or they cheat and spend all your money, or they just take all your money and spend it. You can both be toxic in a relationship. Let's say on your end, you, like, can't maintain work, and you're constantly making fun of how they look, and, like, you guys are always fighting. Okay, but, like, stealing someone's money or giving them an STI or, like, cheating on them is a very different game than, like, coming home and just having, like, petty arguments with your partner. But then what if you're a person who isn't so great with money and your partner is somebody who verbally abuses you every day? Well, maybe in that case, the verbal abuse is worse than being bad with money, right? It's, like, the why matters. It's not exactly the details. It's the why and, like, how they occur and what context they're occurring. So I feel like... Painting Johnny Depp as equally as abusive as Amber is wrong, and painting Johnny as a saint is also wrong, but I think painting Amber as a victim equal to Johnny is wrong, and then painting Amber Heard as only a bad person is also wrong. I'm sure Amber has redeeming qualities to her. The sad fact is, though, during this court case, it was very hard to tell. Like, there were people who only came back to court because Amber, quote-unquote, came back into their lives when she realized they'd be called to the stand and was like, hey, I want to make up. I want to be friends again. Like, haven't you ever met those people in your life that only come back into your life when they want something? That's what Amber feels like to me. Amber feels like the kind of person that's only friends with you if she can get something out of your friendship. Even with her own sister. Even with her own sister. She's the one who kicked her sister out of Johnny's house, not Johnny Depp. Like, that's interesting to me, right? That's interesting because I have siblings. And we've never, like, kicked each other out of each other's houses, but we've had conversations about boundaries, which is different. Like, that's different than getting in a fight being like, I'm going to hold over your head that you live with me, and I'm going to kick you out when it feels convenient for me, like a power move. It's different than saying, hey, we're fighting a lot. Do you think it's better if we don't live together? That is a different conversation than I'm going to kick you out because I'm mad at you, which is what happened with Amber and her sister, right? Like, these things are different things, right?
Anything else. And because of that, and actually just because I want to, I'm still going to watch Johnny Depp films. I'm still going to watch Aquaman.
I'm not watching Aquaman. Those movies suck so bad.
And two. And that is because Johnny Depp, like his ex-wife, is a commercial product. He is a public figure, an artist.
He's also a person.
On this channel, I like hard truths. And here is another one. Johnny Depp is not our friend. He is not a nice guy or a bad guy or whatever you want to brand him. We don't and realistically never will know him. And therefore, realistically, we cannot make...
Speak for yourself. Johnny Depp and I are like 3 degrees removed. We could be best friends one day. Just kidding. I have no idea what we're removed by. But like I don't think people think Johnny Depp's their friend unless they're crazy. But I think people identify with Johnny and people feel connected to Johnny through a parasocial relationship. Does she fail to understand Depp isn't an Aquaman? No, she's talking about Amber Heard movies. Discord's asking that. No. Amber's in Aquaman movies. And she's trying to say, like, I'm still going to watch Aquaman even though Amber Heard's in it. I'm not going to watch Aquaman because it sucks. I already tried to watch previews or, like, clips from it. It's so bad.
make these kinds of assertions of his character and personhood in the way that we tend to be doing now on social media feeds. He is a phenomenal actor.
But you can know Johnny Depp's a good person because of the way he, like, contributes to the children's hospitals and the way his friends talk about him and the way his ex-girlfriends talk about him. Like, you don't... It doesn't take a fucking genius to watch that trial and to watch the way people talk about Johnny. Like, how hard is it to know? Like, saying you don't know if Johnny Depp's a good person is like saying if you don't know Kidology is a good person. You seem fine, girlfriend. Like, do you know what I mean? How famous do you have to be before I can't decide if you're a good person? Because I feel like you can tell. Like, I could tell. You can tell when people have, like, good energy. And usually you can tell when they don't. And for the most part, like, Johnny Depp has pretty good energy. So, I don't know if she believes what she's even saying here. Like, how famous do you have to get to where people aren't allowed to know if you're a good person? That seems really silly.
And his public image and persona is incredibly enchanting. That makes a lot more sense to deduce from his public appearances as an actor, as well as in a public court. Jack Sparrow is a hero, a character with marketable value. But Johnny Depp, the man, most definitely is not. The rhetoric around Johnny Depp reminds me significantly of the same kind of rhetoric South Africans had around Nelson Mandela, our first democratically elected president. The issue was that in making Nelson Mandela a hero, inevitably he was set up for disappointment because it failed to appreciate that he was a man. Heroes always fail to live up to fantastical expectations of those who brand them as such. In the case of Johnny Depp, the expectations are somewhere along the line.
Host says, I haven't watched a trial, but when talking about energy, what happens with narcissists and such who are super charismatic? Don't people get good energy from them temporarily? Narcissists are only so good at convincing you they have good energy until you realize they don't, right? So I feel like even narcissists, if you're really good at reading energy, eventually you'll be like, I feel like you're off and I don't know why, but out of the goodness of our hearts, obviously, we still engage. And sometimes you won't see it coming. Sometimes you can be really tricked. Sometimes people are charismatic. But I just don't, I don't think you can keep it up long term. I think eventually it shows, like, all the narcissists or people that I think are narcissists that I've seen, eventually people catch on. It becomes clear. Like with Amber, she can't maintain or hold down friendships. No one in her life is consistent. It was even pointed out in the trial, like, I just think there's something about Amber, like, if you... Yeah, I think there's just something there where you're not as reliable. Like, the narcissists aren't as reliable or consistent. And that's not the same as having narcissistic personality disorder and actually working on your disorder and going to therapy and trying to be a better person. That's different, too. Crazy Candy says, do you think this case can give hope to other celebrities who are unfairly judged and accused of terrible things without any proof? I hope so. I mean, I don't know. I just feel like this is always going to happen. And that's why you have to have a really good inner circle and people who are in your life that you are dedicated to. And I think that shows. Because, like, even with my stalker, when shit hit the fan, I learned who my real friends were at that time. And it took me a long time to realize it. And I now, that's why I'm so, like, hardcore about my inner circle. Because truly, like, if you have no one in your corner batting for you, it's so difficult. And it can be a reflection that you've rejected everyone in your life and you're not worthy of friendship. Or you could be a person who has no one in your corner because genuinely your life has gone that way and you are a good person and you just happen to not have anyone in your corner. I think that's what's so scary. It's like, you really can be a good person with no one in your corner, and you can be a very bad person with no one in your corner because you're a bad person. And that's what's so scary, is like, that's why it's so hard to know people. Like, someone said that, Destiny said that about himself. He was like, someone said, aren't you the problem, Destiny, if everyone's always, like, stopping to be, like, if no one wants to be your friend, except the truly weird people? And the truth is that I think Destiny is a person that people want to make a bad guy, but he really isn't one. And I think there's a good reason why he breaks and burns all those bridges. And it's not because he's a bad person. I think he's a really good person. I think just Destiny is that person. Like, Destiny is a good person. And I think he just he burns a lot of the bridges around him, because I think a lot of people in this sphere are not the greatest people, which is why it's really hard to make friends. Like with Melina and Erdite, Kyla and I, we were like, are we negotiating our friendship on stream right now? Like, that was so fun, but it was still nerve-wracking. Like, I'm still nervous. I still have a lot of, like, anxiety over making friends online because, you know, you get hurt a lot of the time and then you want to be vulnerable with people, but it's like, you know, you don't want to put it on them. You don't want to, like, force them to, like, be there for you, because you also have other friends, but not all your friends understand YouTube. So it's difficult to balance all of these friendships. How much do you want of me? What is your expectation? Am I allowed to be my vulnerable self? What does that look like? Are you going to make a video about me later? It's like, yeah, all those anxieties exist, especially in the content creator field, which is, I'm surprised why Kidology, does Kidology not see herself the way Johnny is? Because I just see Johnny as, like, me, but, like, famous times 1,000. Do you know what I'm saying? So I think the problems are the same. Whether you're uber famous or not famous at all, if you're a public figure, you're still dealing with, like, being canceled, or if people make videos about you that aren't true, or taking your shit out of context. I'm surprised Kidology can't relate to Johnny Depp in that human way, because that's how I see Johnny. I'm like, oh, if Johnny Depp was a YouTuber, this is like if he's a YouTuber and people are saying bad things about him. You know what I mean? You know?
Of the legal process becoming fairer for men and women, male victims of domestic violence being able to come forward and being believed, the hashtag MeToo movement becoming purer and far less one-sided. And these are all admirable beliefs and pursuits, but they are just that. Pursuits that we as a world and global community are a long way from even laying a fingertip on, and beliefs that have nothing substantively to do with the reality which the vast majority of the global population lives and experiences. This trial has most definitely brought into the public.
Andrea says, I feel like it's important to keep in mind that good people can still do bad things because it's human. If Johnny got bad press in a while from now, people would probably turn around and hate him again. It's true. Good people can do bad things, and I think Johnny Depp is probably a good person who's done bad things, and I think Amber Heard's a bad person who pretends to do good things. That's my belief. I think Amber is probably a bad person, but I don't know her personally, and I say Johnny Depp is most likely a good person, even though I don't know him personally. Is Destiny live again? Oh, how fun. That's good, because I want to watch the discussion with him and Erudite and Mr. Girl. Persephone says, people on Discord, I'm not, you did the understand myself test, right? Did you find common traits in the group? Yes, I found that on my Discord for the people who took the test. Many of them ranked really high on openness and kind of low on politeness. But I think the high on openness was the thing we almost shared universally. I could be wrong. We have a thread dedicated to our tests, but I'm pretty sure we all got pretty high on openness, which would make sense because I think introspection, like, requires openness. And I think a lot of people are pulled to my channel because they're on this, like, introspection journey. Yeah.
Public psyche, mine included, that men can be and oftentimes are victims of domestic abuse and violence. And this is an important conversation to be having, no doubt. It has, however, failed to appreciate that the likelihood of men and women who come forward actually being able to get justice or compensation for their ordeals is largely determined by how much money they have in the bank, how much money they are willing and able to spend, and how large a social media following they are able to garner before going to trial, which can be used by a PR team to sway the public opinion on their side. The vast majority of victims, men and women, will not receive justice. The law won't be on their side, and neither will truth. The law, regrettably, as we see it today in modern societies, is not on the side of truth. It is on the side of that.
Name one time it has been. Why do we all talk like this in this day and age, at this time in history, at this modern, like, who fucking, bro, it's always been this way. Jesus done got crucified by his own people because people weren't seeking truth. They were seeking revenge. That's what I'm saying. When in history are we just always going to be like, I can't believe we're living through this time in history. Bitch, everybody lives through this time in history. All of our ancestors said that bullshit. Everyone said that bullshit. We're saying it now. We're not. This isn't a solution. You have given me zero solutions, kid. Zero solutions. You're saying the same thing everyone's been saying. Yes, I can't believe we live in this time where, wow, this thing we're doing is happening. Yes, I know. Okay. Which is why you have to, like, regularly accept we're in cycles. Humans repeat history. It is what it is, guys, right? It is what it is.
That which feeds it, which is money. And that is all. What never was can never perish. Thank you so much for watching this video. I will be keeping the comment section open, so please leave your thoughts below.
Thanks, girl. I tried, girl. I tried. It's just like, okay, yeah, we get it. Like, we get it. I don't know. Even the freaking pandemic is not special for our time. Exactly. It's like everything we're going through is not even unique for us. Like, all of our ancestors have gone through it, and we're just like in this blip of history. That's what I'm saying. We think we're special, but we are just in our own blip of history. Like, everyone's going to read about our time and be like, I can't believe they lived through that. And I'm like, I guess it's just our own existence. It's just what it is. And then future generations will be like, I can't believe we're living in 2300, blah, 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 where so-and-so group is still so-and-so. You know what I mean? It just feels really silly. Like, acting like we're experiencing something for the first time, or, and maybe we are with technology, I guess, but it's just, it seems really silly to me. I can't believe it's not butter. this time in history really do be a time in history. I can't believe they had hot tub streams. Exactly what they're going to be saying. I can't believe they did hot tub streams. Can you believe it? It's so funny.